much and our best wishes to Peter and to Smiley Jones at this time.
Mr. Chairman.
And also apologies from Councillor Joe Diasha. Any apologies? No. You have to excuse me, I've had an operation a couple of weeks back and I'm still recovering. So if my voice goes, it's not because I've got a cold or I've had too much to drink last night. I'm just trying to control myself as I go through this. So apologies if my voice can't go through the achievements. I'll try my best to keep things forward the best I can. Okay, no other apologies? Okay, we do have a request to film the proceedings. Does anybody object to the proceeding being filmed? No? Okay, we now have to start the filming. I would say if any members have any information that might be private or confidential, just to ensure that it's not left out on the board, not for view. Also, if members can please put their mobile phones on silent or switch it off so it doesn't disturb us during the meeting. And also, we're not expecting any fire alarm test at all this afternoon. So if a fire alarm does go, then just please call one of our officers in white shirts. And if anybody requires the toilets, just go up the doors, turn to the left, and they're just on the right hand side. Okay, this is the budget meeting. So does everybody have a copy of the budget resolution?
Yes.
Yeah. That budget resolution was sent out in accordance with the standing orders of the authority. There was a request if any member has any amendments to make to that budget resolution, and we haven't received any amendments to that. So the budget resolution is as it stands. We'll obviously have that discussion when we come to that item. We just wanted to ensure that everybody's aware of that, position. Okay. Is there any declarations of interest of any items on the agenda from any members or officers? No? There's no other additional items. We do have an exempt item, which is item number 8, which we will be asking for the exclusion of the public. So when we come to that item, I will let you know and ask you to leave the room so we consider that item. Okay, if we go on to the agenda, item 2 is the minutes from the previous meeting. Is that agreed?
Some of the membership needs to be updated.
Oh, right. No, just if we, on the membership list.
We'll draw that to you.
There's Liam, Councillor Liam Clark, and Edna Finn, that's not included in the list. So item 3 is the provisional authority dates for the forthcoming municipal year. Has everybody had the opportunity to have a look at them? Is there any issues there, any errors or omissions?
Just a
point
of information for myself. So the actual authority meeting meets three times a year. I'm so sorry. the police authority. The fire authority meets in full body three times a year, and the others are all as listed.
Yes, so it's usually two or four meetings, yeah. Or we could have additional special meetings as and when required. Okay, so are we happy with those dates?
Yes, Chief.
Agreed, Chairman, yeah.
Thank you very much. Item 4 is the asset management plans for 2018 to 2019. Item 4 is the asset management plans. Obviously quite detailed plans there for all the assets we have, vehicles, lands, ICT, quite a detailed one. We need to approve that obviously ahead of the budget because it all comes in the budget resolution of the budget proposals that we have set for the forthcoming year. So do we have any questions or any comments on that?
Yes, Chair, thank you. Just one thing. First of all, it was a real pleasure to visit Prescott this week to see the Joint Fire Police Station there. As a result of the opening of that and it becoming functional, I assume that Wisden and Hampton will become available for disposal. It's not indicated as that. I just wondered what the sort of time frame was for that.
The link station's already been disposed of to where housing that was coming off on the last month.
But yeah, it's the art business to be disposed of. And council receipts will be there from them. We'll go back into the council. So we're happy to approve the asset management plan, is that agreed?
Agreed, Chairman.
Okay, item five now is the budget proposals for the forthcoming year. It's not easy to find the final, it takes us up to 2023. I'll ask Ian Cummins, our treasurer, just to go through your chief overview of the budget resolution.
The budget report presented to the authority provides the necessary financial information for members to approve financial strategy that sets a balanced 2018-19 revenue budget preset level in line with the relevant statutory requirements. Subject to all the financial assumptions remaining robust and the identification and implementation of £426,000 of supported service savings in 1920, the proposed financial plan will deliver a balanced financial position up to and including 2019-20. Due to the uncertainty over the future government financial support from 2021, the authority is recommended to note any financial challenge from 2021 at this time. As the level of government financial support beyond 1920 becomes known, future budget plans will consider how to deal with any financial challenge. The report itself sets out in paragraphs 52 to 72, on page 111 to 116, the proposed 5-year capital programme and prudential borrowing requirements. And as per the table on page 112, the total capital programme provides for an investment of £31.9 million, of which £20.4 million is being funded by prudential borrowing. New schemes totaling £5.5 million have been added to the current capital programme, but most of this increase relates to the addition of the rolling extra year 2022-23. Paragraphs 73 to 83 on page 117 to 118 outline how the minimum revenue provision, which is the sum that will be set aside each year to repay outstanding historic and future debt associated with the capital expenditure, will be calculated. Paragraph 84 to 93 on pages 119 to 121 outline the impact of the proposed capital investments over a number of predetermined prudential indicators to determine its affordability and sustainability. Paragraphs 94 to 96, pages 122 to 131 outline the authority's treasury management strategy. The proposed investment strategy is consistent with the current strategy and recommends continuing with the current institutional limits and minimum credit ratings. The proposed authorised limit for debt, £56 million, will ensure that the total gross debt does not exceed the capital financing requirements and that borrowing is only incurred to cover capital investment. The sections I've just outlined consider all costs associated with the proposed 5-year capital programme and prudential borrowing. These costs have been built into the proposed medium-term financial plan, and therefore the proposed capital programme and associated borrowing is deemed to be sustainable and affordable. As outlined on page 132, paragraph 100, at last year's budget authority meeting, members approved £11 million of savings and efficiencies that delivered a balanced plan up to 1920. Therefore, in theory, if all the assumptions in last year's plan remain consistent, then the authority would simply need to ratify last year's plan to set a balanced budget for 2018-19 and consider if it wished to extend the current financial plan to 2022-23. However, paragraphs 101 to 112 on pages 132 to 138 outline for members the new cost pressures or changes to the 2017-18 plan on the assumption that members support a just under 3% PSEP increase in 2018-19 and 2019-20, the table at the bottom of page 137 summarises the recommended amendments to the current plan as discussed at the January Budget Strategy Day. As a consequence, the authority must identify £271,000 and £734,000 of new savings and efficiencies in 2018-19 and 2019-20, rising to potentially £1.2 million by 2022-23. Section H on page 139 to 143 looks at possible saving options for the authority to consider in order to rebalance the proposed financial plan up to 2019-20. The table on page 142 summarises the proposals to balance the plan up to 2019-20. The saving proposals include a £426,000 saving on support services with effect 2019-20. And as per paragraph 128, the Chief Fire Officer will reduce support functions during 2018 to deliver a minimum saving of £426,000 by 2019-20. As outlined in paragraph 117 on page 139, due to the significant uncertainty over the government future financial support beyond 2019-20, the authorities recommended to simply note the projected financial challenge beyond 1920. Future budget authority meetings will consider the challenge beyond 1920 as the financial information becomes more certain. Pages 144 to 147 identify the anticipated reserves over the financial plan period and the proposed use of these reserves. The authority is recommended to maintain a general fund reserve at the current level of £2 million, which equates to 3% of the net operating expenditure budget. Finally, pages 148 to 149 identifies the £27.9 million needs to be raised from the council tax precept in 2018-19 to balance the revenue budget, and that equates to a band D council tax precept demand of £76.56, an increase of 2.99% on the 2017-18 figure of £74.34. Members are asked to approve the report recommendations 2A to 2J. I'm happy to take any questions on the report.
Thanks. So, just before we open up, I'll just ask the Chief now just to give an overview of the operation consequences.
Thank you, Chair. This, two paragraphs of note for members. The first is paragraph 104, which is at the bottom of page 133, that's under section G, revenue forecast. And then the next is the one which I would ask you to refer to now, please, members, is paragraph 125, which is on page 144, which is under the heading options for tackling the future financial challenge. What paragraph 125 sets out that the current financial plan is assuming £1.9 million of savings from response, which is a reduction of just over 55 out of posts from the original position, and it is this which has caused us to have to change the clearing on six fire appliances from 24/7 immediate response to 12-hour immediate response and 12-hour response on a 30-minute retained recall. There are only two stations or two appliances rather that we are yet to implement that current change on, as a Liverpool City and Wallasey, and that would be planned for early 2019. The point that is made within the narrative in 125 is that we are not assuming any further savings can be made from the operational budget. I just say at this juncture, members, it is my professional view, as I've stated on numerous times previously, that these savings that we are having to make at this time seriously compromises our operational response model. And I've used the term previously that the line is some way behind us now. I think it's important that I make that point again and I place that on the record. And I know that that is a position that is also shared by our colleagues in the representative bodies, and let me be clear that I fully agree with their position in relation to that. Just to conclude then, members, we recognise that there are likely to be further pressures that emerge throughout 2018, not least with the outcomes of the Dean Judith Hackett review into the Grenfell incident, and that is likely to place pressure in particular on our protection departments of alleged fire safety. It is my intention, therefore, that within the 620 whole-time equivalent post allocation to potentially redistribute some of the posts within that number, and any changes that are made as a result of that, I understand, will have to be broadly cost neutral because of the financial pressures that are faced by the authority. So that is something that I would do under the scheme of delegation. So what I'm saying there is, members, I recognise the limitations under which I am operating in that regard. Nothing more for me to say on that, members. I think I've probably set out the position as I need to, so I will pause at that point. Thank you.
Okay, thanks for that, Chief. Just before we open up for any questions or observations, usual thing is for myself and the Vice Chair is that we put the offer to the representative bodies for trade unions to meet prior to today's budget meeting. We met with FOA and we met with the FBU. What I'd like to do now is if those trade union reps, whether they wish to make any contribution at this stage, we would like to go first.
Thank you, Jay. And thanks for giving us the opportunity to speak. Can I just say the Chief Fire Officer is absolutely right when he says the line in the sand is way behind us. We totally agree on that. And as we previously stated, through the IRMP plan that you passed for 2017 to 2020, it is only through the dedication and hard work and commitment of all of this authority's employees that the last 10 years of swingeing cut have not had a more or a bigger detrimental effect on the communities that we serve. And it's our belief, by the way, that we're actually running into the realms of luck rather than prevention or anything else there. But it's Merseyside FBU members who continue to work over and above their contractual hours or their contractual rate of pay to deliver the savings for this service and to deliver the fire cover that, although it is a line in the sand behind us, we still have. And despite continually being asked to do more for less, we do recognise the serious financial constraints that are placed on the authority, and it's nothing short of a disgrace. We've said it before, Chair. It's nothing short of a disgrace the way that this Tory government treat the fire service as a whole in the UK, but in particular Merseyside Fire Service. Notwithstanding the financial restraints, there are some use of the authority's money that we don't agree with. The continued use of resilience payments, for example, is a real bind for our members. Following a Freedom of Information request, we now estimate that over £1 million will have been spent on these contracts, and we just don't think that is right. For that reason, our members are reviewing their current agreements to work overtime. And notwithstanding that, I'm trying to keep this within the budget, we will continue to work with the service and with the authority to jointly lobby this government to get proper funding for this fire and rescue service. I'm not even going to talk about our pay claim, because that's separate. That's separate, and it's got nothing to do with what's taking place in this room at this time. It's actually a disgrace that our firefighters aren't paid the right amount of money, by the way. We will continue to lobby hard to government and anybody else that listens, and for people in this room as well, you are councillors, you represent your communities, and you can do more as well to lobby and to engage those members of the public and unite and bring them forward in lobbying our government for proper funding for our fire and rescue service. But the chief is right, there is a line in the sand on behind us, and we can no longer tolerate any future cuts, including some of the cuts that are proposed in within this IRMP update and within the budget proposals that you're asking to do. We won't tolerate any more job losses. We just cannot do that, and we certainly cannot do that while we have £25 million in reserves. And thank you for your time.
Thanks, Chair. I'm Rob Pritchard from the Fire. I share lots of the views with my colleagues from FBU, our members as well, work above and beyond to deliver a fire service to the membership or the communities of Merseyside. We understand the tensions around the resilience payments, but our membership believes that as a service, we shouldn't be going out on strike. And until that is delivered nationally, which I don't think it ever will, and understand that TUC and the FBUs like to want to be able to strike, I have no problems with that. But our membership feel that as emergency service, that's the wrong thing to do in any circumstances. We recognise the challenge for the authority and the chief. Quite rightly, we've seen a number of incidents over the last couple of years, where this service, traditionally one of the best performing, still is best performing, has struggled to maintain a level of response that we should have. And I think we are, as the Chief said, well past that point. And I welcome the strategy that's been set out on Budget Strategy Day, where the operational element of the service is going to be the last place for future cuts, because you can't cut anymore. Because if you do, things larger or more dramatic than doing a car park fire are going to happen. We did a fantastic job there, but we were very lucky that there was no one hurt. The next one, we might not be so lucky. Thanks, Chair.
Thanks. So, any other comments?
Seconding the resolution, Chairman, can I first of all start by thanking our officers in the Finance Department for preparing a budget which has been set out. It's a sad day when we have to make these decisions, but thank you for the staff for putting the options in black and white in as least painful perhaps a way. It's always painful. I'd like to thank our officers. I'd like to thank all the staff of the authority, and I'm sure we all want to put it on public record. That no matter what job they do, the public can truly consider them to be heroes. They're running into the face of fires and tragedies when other people are running away, as has often been said. But I'm afraid the country undervalues them. The government certainly undervalues them. The press undervalue the job that is done. And it is only that this country has been faced with a number of challenges this year that the work of the fire service has and will continue to be in such clear focus. We have a number of reviews, the Manchester Review, the London Review, any reviews that come out of what happened at the tragedy in the car park. Whatever reviews we will face us and bracket us and prepare us wherever we move in the very short term. But we've today got to make decisions which are part of a multi-year budget. Many of the things that have been talked about today are actually decisions that have already been made. We've made decisions to try and find the 11, now the £12.5 million gap. Having said that, none of these decisions we would make if we didn't have to. Given a free rein, we would be investing more, okay, in a changing world, we would be investing more in safer firefighters, a a safer authority, safer communities. But as we say, Chairman, having said all of the bad stuff that's happening to us, we are, as members, still confident that we retain the safest part of Britain to live from a fire point of view. We have only full-time firefighters, we have no retained. We operate a 10-minute attendance target and probably just over 5 minutes in actuality, but we will still be tested. I don't think, there's a number of choices. I don't think really that there's anything that's not in this budget today that we don't have to do. We are forced into this position. We are the executioners for the government writ. We know that, we've had that before. If anybody could think, and today was too late to do it, if anybody could think of any other ways or means of saving the 12 and a half million, 11 million this budget, please let us know. You know, the reserves, if you refer to page 165, you'll see the list of reserves. It's wrongly branded as reserves. It's not reserves. We've got in reserve, as we were told, about 3 million. And you've got Bell Reserve, bits and pieces. Yes, okay, we could take new dimensions. What's that? A million and 99. Well, that's about planning. That's money there for if the worst of things happen. You can pick anything out of here. Training reserve, we need that. Do we need new boots? Yeah, well, let's just throw that in. You know, there's lots of stuff there which we are buying out of capital or which are being funded from capital, which if we didn't do would either result in shutting a fire station, having no boots, or having to make firefighters redundant. None of those things we want to do. It's a simple message. There is no miraculous pot of money. We wouldn't be making the painful, painful decisions that are in the Labour resolution today if there was a magic pot of money that could just, with one great leap, our hero is free. I mean, all of us are the same on our own local authorities. There we are. So it's a shame that we find ourselves, well, you know, in the position we are. I believe that we, as members of the authority, are doing the best we can in the circumstances we have. And that I do hope we will, no matter what, be able to retain a situation where the people we represent are still kept the safest in the country. From that point of view, Chair, I'm happy to second this resolution.
That's right.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. It's with a heavy heart that I also support the resolution. But before I do, I want to place on record my congratulations, because everything I've seen from all the staff employed by the Spire Authority since I came on 2 years ago, which have been absolutely fantastic. I'm totally impressed by dedication, commitments, professionalism of all the staff. And it is a disgrace that good staff like that are put in a position by this government where their commitments and dedication and loyalty is taken for granted, or they'll do whatever they need to do if there's ever an emergency. And to be honest, Chair, I will never ever forgive this government for putting us in this position today. And I'll be voting for this resolution. I'll be voting for it on the basis that there's no alternative. We've got to go down this road. In an ideal world, we wouldn't be sitting here talking about cuts of 50% reduction in the revenue support grants since 2010. We wouldn't be talking about losing, as I understand it, 350 firefighter posts and 200 support staff by the next financial year. And appliances are being cut back, the number of stations are being cut back. It's an absolute disgrace that we as a fire authority are being placed in this position, and the staff and their representatives who spoke today are being placed in this position. So yeah, I will support the budget, Chair, but I think a message needs to go back very clear. And I think the FBU and the FOA have said we need to lobby this government. Well, I'm more than happy to be part of any lobbying of this government to make them see sense, to make them realise that if they want a decent fire service in this country, they've got to pay for it, and they can't just sit back and rely upon individuals' dedication and loyalty to see everybody through. It's a disgrace, but I will support it, Chair. Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks for that, Mike. Thanks.
Thank you, Chair. I mean, I also will support this budget today. And clearly, you know, there's one of me. I haven't any idea what the other opposition member will do. But I think, you know, we have actually got down to the bone on this. I am quite happy to continue lobbying the members of my government, which I was doing only a fortnight ago with the Home Secretary. I won't go into the conversations that we had, but clear enough to say she went away from Merseyside knowing what my feelings were in respect of not only just the fire service, but also police, because as you know, my previous life was in an emergency service. I think if I was to not vote for this today, it would not be seen as myself being honourable, because clearly I cannot come up with any alternative here today. If I could, then quite clearly I would. I cannot see, other members have talked about their own local authorities. I think here we have done the right thing. We've got our priorities right. We are trying as best we can to maintain no compulsory redundancies, and we're trying as best we can to ensure that we keep the people of Merseyside safe. They are the priorities of the authority, and they are my priorities. And I cannot see that we can do this any other way than to agree this budget. So obviously it's with extremely heavy heart that I'm even supporting a Labour budget resolution, but I personally can't see any other alternative. If we go back over the years, I've been on the Fire Authority now for 10 years. When I came on, it was a government of a different colour. I appreciate that. We were having cuts there. We are having cuts now, and I don't believe, like the rest of the members, I'm sure here, that that is sustainable for any longer. What I will say, if you're all thinking that 2020, a different government will come in of a different colour, and they will come in with sack loads of money, then I would say to you, you're probably deluded on that, but that's an argument for another day. But unlike my own local authority, where I have to say I'm also at odds with what their priorities are, they have a huge budget, and how they spend it would not be my priorities. And I would just go back to say that the priorities that I think that we have here are solid and they're honourable. And I too, you know, I'm the only Tory on this authority, but I do sincerely give my full backing to the firefighters and the support staff that we have, because I think they do a wonderful job. And I will speak up for them at every single opportunity. And as I say, Chair, I will join you and other members from cross-party at whatever meetings I possibly can, and I will continue to do that with colleagues, ministers and secretaries of state when I get the opportunity from my own government. So I will support your budget today.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Okay.
Yeah, just for the FBU members and all the unions, quite correct, Kevin, and what you said about councillors, you know, getting out there and you know, spreading the word. The last full council meeting, the Crow City Council, a motion was passed and supported by both sides of the House in regards to the cuts that yous are all facing. And each and every one of us spoke up about the different aspects of what you deliver. I spoke about hazmat and USAR, and others spoke about the Prince's Trust. We spoke about every aspect of what the firefighters have done. So we are battling away behind the scenes, okay? And I think me and Nick, we had a little gap the other day, and we said any motions that come through from any authority should be filtered through to all the unions, so you know that you're not on, you know? Okay, so, thanks, Chair.
Thanks, Chair.
First of all, thank you for your support for this. It's great to hear that Councillor met the Home Secretary and explained to her the concerns that she's got regarding the fire service. When the Home Secretary visited Merseyside, she came, obviously a pre-planned trip. However, she gave the Chief and I 10 minutes jointly in her itinerary, but I'm glad that she gave me more time, hopefully, and you were able to reinforce some of the messages she would have got from us. But I did, at the time, I was underwhelmed by the attention that she was prepared to give us. Then listening to the Chief Fire Officer, the representative of the FBU and the representative of the FOA, it's very sobering for us as members of the public, representatives as we are, to hear of the circumstances the fire service is in. Just taking us back to something we discussed in the December meeting,
This authority voted in June by 15-1 to support further reform, proposed reform of the fire authority. And we discussed back in December the difficulties that you, Chair, were having in carrying that forward. I wonder if you could say a little bit more about any progress that you might have been able to make and whether the benefits that the fire authority voted for coming to the budget of the fire service are able to be achieved.
Okay. First of all, I'd just like to thank you all for their comments. I always welcome your thoughts because you represent our frontline workers. They're the guys and girls who actually go up there every day, you know, what we expect is a professional job, and put their own lives at risk while we can't. And I think this authority are grateful. Thank all our staff because I mean the organisation without those backup supports and technical people, staff that there, we wouldn't be able to operate as an organisation. So every part of it was filled. And when I cut to the front line and I cut to the backup supports, it still affected our ability to deliver an effective, efficient, first class emergency service. And I think it's a problem, should we say, for national politicians who have a duty to ensure that they protect our communities. And we know that that is not the case. We know the cuts in the police budget, the cuts in the fire budget, the cuts in the health budget, it's having an impact on our communities, on our residents. And, you know, we say enough is enough. You cannot continue downgrade emergency services at this rate and affect that there will be no difference. And it's only because of the dedication and commitment of our staff that go the extra mile that make sure that our service and our communities are protected the way they are. But we got stretched. You know, when we have a big incident like we did with the car park, or, you know, all times on New Year's Eve, a major incident like that, we were stretched to the limit. And you think at that time of the amount of resources that we had to give to that one incident, we had to call on the neighbouring fire and rescue services for their assistance. And you think to yourself, is this going to happen more and more, where we're having to ask for mutual aid from our neighbouring fire and rescue services? And what if at the same time as ourselves having a major incident like that, they also had a major incident like that, and they could not send anybody to assist us, what position would we be placed in? It would be absolutely unbelievable where we couldn't respond and adequately address and curtail that incident, whether it be a fire, major terrorist attack, or a traffic accident. This government needs to undertake a full evaluation of the cuts to the fire and rescue service. We've been saying this year on year. And what do we hear? Well, we don't hear anything. The silence is deafening, as they say. I'm grateful for Leslie's comments of not only support the budget, but also the opportunity to speak directly to the Home Secretary. Because I don't think that they understand the reality what's happening to our emergency services. And it's only if one day one of them needed to have our assistance and we didn't respond appropriately, what would be their response? And I think it's absolutely appalling that they have the gift to do something about this and they don't. We'll lobby, we'll continue to lobby because we have a good solid argument and a good story to tell, because I've always said that what we do in the fire and rescue service, it's not just about saving lives. The way we do with the Princess Trust, the youth engagement team and everything else, it's about changing lives. And we do an absolutely fantastic, excellent, first class job. So it's gone beyond the reams of just what people might think is just responding to fires. We do a lot more than that, and we should take more credit, and people should understand more about the work we actually undertake. And
it is a sad day when you think today we're approving a budget to cut our finances further by another 12 and a half million. So in total from 2010 to 2023, we would have had about £37 million cut from our budget. Almost 50% of our grants, our government grants. And you can't think for 1 minute that will have consequences. That will have an impact. That will someday affect some family. That will affect somebody's life. And you think to yourself, what is the price that you put on a person's life? And they're playing like Russian roulette with people's lives. And it's absolutely disgraceful. And it's a pity that some senior politicians don't seem to have any empathy. You know, you wonder why. They might have been born with a silver spoon in their mouth. You might think that they never need an emergency service, but I'm sure one day they will. When you look at the budget resolution and the things that we have to agree to today to ensure that we have a balanced budget, it is very difficult to have a real impact on our staff. But you can have an assurance that we will do all we possibly can to ensure we protect the service in the best possible ways we can. And we will continue lobbying. We'll speak to the council leaders, we'll speak to the mayors, we'll speak to the members of parliament, we'll speak to shadow ministers, we'll speak to ministers, we'll speak to civil servants, we'll speak to bishops, we'll speak to lords, we'll speak to anyone. Anybody will listen to the devastating cuts that these are having in our communities. And hopefully, one day, somebody will listen. But let's hope it's not too late. You look at the impact of Grenfell Towers. You look at the terrorist attacks on London and in Manchester. We had a seminar not so long ago where Edmund was a professor, I think, on terrorist attacks, gave an overview of how terrorists operate. Now, we're living in a different world, should we say, where we could have 1, 2, or maybe 3 simultaneous attacks in one city at one time. Could we cope with that? That's the question. The thing is, we should have the confidence, we should have the assurance that yes, we can deal with that, and yes, we can protect our communities. But unfortunately, I can't answer that question. I would like to ask the Minister, can you answer that question? I feel it is. They can't. They cannot give you that assurance. If our fire and rescue service isn't funded appropriately, then you know it falls on them. The decision is their decision. It's difficult for us to make, but the finger shouldn't be pointed at us. It should be pointed at government ministers, because that's where the blame lies. So I could go on, but I'm always trying to put that on. Just on James' question as regards the formal authority, at the last meeting we decided to put our hold. What I think I explained at the time, because of negotiations that are ongoing between the Liverpool City Region and the Liverpool City Region Metro Mayor, there's some dialogue being taken place over the last couple of weeks between the Chief Constable and the Chief Fire Officer. And we're in a position now where there's a meeting being arranged with the Metro Mayor